doing for H2K.
All right, so it is in fact that Orianna. Now, do we see the Corki matching? What is Nuke Duck going to go?
If they want earlier game, you can go for something like the
Lucian.
Talia, I was going to say, but Lucian as well, pushing lane. You can get a lot of damage down. This is a lane matchup that we did see quite a lot in the early part of the summer split, where you can utilize this Lucian's presence in the lane. Of course, we saw it in the Telecom Wars as well, the Lucian brought out by Faker. Lots and lots of emphasis on the early game here, and I'm looking forward to seeing how this actually pans out for Nuke Duck. They were afforded this opportunity by having a magic damage threat from the top lane as well. I'm interested by the composition out of Vitality. I quite like it. You've got the scaling threat out of Sealback, you've got team fighting out of Joko and Cabochard. Interesting setup, whereas I think H2K is a little bit more straightforward. You've got the Zac to start team fights, you've got Tahm Kench as well to bring them in, and then Gnar and Orianna, every time they're in a team fight, always have that big impact.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. I feel like, though, for Vitality, you saw the serious faces of the players. It's crunch time for this team. They need to win out to try and make those playoffs. And they need some help for it, too. They're several games back from all the teams at the top of Group B, but it could all start here today. Yamato Cannon, you know, taking over that coaching role on Team Vitality after his stint on Splice. He wants to make this team even better than they were before. Let's see if they can get it done. Otherwise, they will be, unfortunately, mired in fourth place. Mediocrity for another split.
Another split would be fourth for Vitality. As we head on to the Rift, you were talking about other things that would need to happen. For Vitality to make playoffs, they must win this game, and one of the other teams above them must lose every series until the end of the split. It has to be the same team consistently losing. Otherwise, that gap between them is just too big.
Yeah, the placement in the playoffs is all up for grabs right here in Group B. Vitality are hoping to squeeze their way into that pool. But it all starts right here, right now, for game number one between H2K and Vitality. As we load up onto the Rift, we'll see where the early action goes. You mentioned early game, oh so important. And we know Vitality have struggled with getting early game leads. So it seems encouraging that they've decided to draft towards that end.
They came into the split with a little bit more emphasis on the early game. Now, I wouldn't say their whole composition is early game focused from Vitality. And Maokai is quite hands-off when it comes to the early levels.
Branches, if you will.
Yeah, branches. Branches out into the late game. The Xayah can have the impact in the laning phase if the Thresh lands the hook. Those are the types of things for the early game that are a little bit more chance. It's that Lucian that can have the lane dominance early on, should have the lane dominance. And that's why we got to keep our eyes on that middle lane. Lucian should be able to push in early, punish the Orianna until you get pretty much out of the laning phase. That's when Orianna will really have that presence.
So I'm curious if, you know, the Maokai doesn't have to be super active early on, but if Joko elects to take a lot of visits to that mid lane, could that not help their chances? We saw what happened yesterday with Splice. Trashy was camping that mid lane, and I'll be damned if Senkuks didn't pop off.
And that's why I want to kind of reiterate on the fact that Maokai can be hands-off. We've also seen people flash into mid lane at level 2 and WP.
That's true, yeah.
As you said yesterday, we saw a lot of Trashy and Senkuks. I think when you're going up against the likes of a Zac, who can always be around to counter gank, it's always a difficult one actually getting in for a successful gank. You can see Joko having a little bit of trouble with the pull, gets the blue buff, and now will end up on his Wolves. Had Steelback and Vanda there to pull for him, but likewise, Nuclear and Shay were on their way to the lane in the bottom side, so no distinct advantage right now for that level 2 rush in the bottom lane.
Yeah, not as sick of a leash as we saw the other week with the Maokai, where he was already up at red buff when he got the blue.
Right.
That was pretty smooth, but all the same, he's able to get his good start off.
One thing to note is the blue, there was a ward on the red buff of Joko in Vitality's jungle, and basically it was spotting to see whether Joko was doing a route where he ends up on red and then looks towards the top lane early on to try and punish Odoamne. Now, that's not what Joko was doing, so we have to track the rest of his progress through the jungle. Jankos is basically able to just track him up through the map on similar camps and just end up on the top side roughly at the same time.
I mean, you gotta think Odo won't be expecting that early gank up in the top side. You heard him say it earlier. He doesn't have his little doggy anymore, Cabochard, for that early pressure. Maybe Joko says, oh yeah? Woof woof.
we'll see whether he... Woof woof. Wow.
He's got a cat skin, I know. It's cats and dogs, I got a mixed up stress.
At least it's not raining at this point. Look, now Joko goes into Yanko's jungle, knows he was a little faster on that clear to get there. And Yanko's actually gets pushed away from the blue. If that resets, that's a pretty sizable win for Joko. Now, they both have their smites available, but Yanko's has to back himself away. The important follow-on here is there is already a ward on the top side which denies Joko's ability to get into the lane. But look, Joko's full health. He can just stand around here and deny Jankos for a little bit.
Yeah, that's a feels bad, man.
Look at this. The fact that Febiven is getting pushed in by this Lucian as expected means Jankos cannot contest his own blue at this point. It's a little risky for Joko if he continues to stay, if, for instance, Oduamne leaves the lane. But look at where Jankos is going here, trying to make something happen on the top side of the map. It's one of the options that Jankos actually has available.
All right, he hops in. Let's get one pull, and now that means Oduamne is going to be able to throw the boomerang at him. But Kabushar doesn't take that much damage, and it's going to free this red buff or this blue buff up over to Joko. So this is a good start for Vitality.
Oh, and look at the mid lane. Vanzer is heading towards there as well. But Joko, look, Vitality are trying to keep early game pressure in the lane and push forward, try and take as much away from H2K as they can. I like this early game attempt out of Vitality, trying to really deny this Zac.
Joko is not done. Oh, Jankos is going to have such a hard time in this jungle. They're even bringing Kabushard now. Vitality are zeroing in on trying to get these early advantages, and they don't need to do it through kills. 4 minutes in, it's not a whole lot of gold or anything, but that's going to stack up really quick when the jungler level difference starts coming in.
Yeah, you're denying Jankos that ability to get to the level 6, trying to deny him his early jungle path. And look, he's helped out by the fact that because Vander came out of the lane, there's a ward on Krugs, there's a ward on Raptors. Now, Che admittedly is now looking for a mid lane play themselves. But Nukeduck, he's a little ahead on the CS. Joko's going to cross over a ward, so this should kind of neutralize any play in that middle lane. But you can see this is already the kind of success around the middle lane pushing it in that Vitality we're expecting to have.
Yeah, and for Vitality, you know, we've talked about it week in and week out. Nukeduck has been a consistent win condition for this team. And he is a very solid player, but we'll talk about
Odo,
that more in
yeah.
a minute, because instant flash follow through. There's the root. Joko gets a Bramble Smash out.
They've got it.
He flashed forward. He's looking for a Narbecue, but it's going to be the tree that secures first blood. Joko with the flash follow through.
I really like this early game out of Vitality. Difficult to deal with in the fact that H2K have picked a Zac that needs a little bit more time to get in. The Orianna was getting pushed in, and they've focused on the top half of the map, getting now Oduamne. The first kill of the game goes over to Joko. I like what they've been doing. It's a good usage of time out for Joko, and it's really neutralizing the effect that Jankos can have on the game.
Yeah, there we go. So I'm going to go back to my point about Nukeduck, because he has been so integral to the team, but he's clearly not the only win condition. And in this particular game, it's going to be hard for him, it seems, on his own to break through, because he's up against Febiven, who's having, honestly, a really solid split, and he's on a safe mid laner.
On a safe mid lane. A lot of people call Febiven in the audience today, by the sounds of it. But as we look at that mid lane, talking about safe mid laners, that's one of the reasons why H2K has picked up this Orianna. But we got to focus on
Joko. He doesn't have to be safe.
Yeah, he's killed him in the river at that point.
Oh, no, Joko.
Like, Febiven walks out of the lane, finds Joko. I was looking for the minimap to try and see where, in fact, Nukeduck was. He was sat in the lane just trying to farm out the back of it. And Febiven just ends up picking up an easy kill of all of the good work that Joko had done. Remember, no flash was available from being in that top side, flashing forward. Febiven ends up just finding him and killing him.
Poor guy. He should have made like a tree and gotten the hell out of there. Nukeduck stepping forward, double tap onto Febiven, but he's got the shield to keep himself safe. And let's take a look at what Che's doing. He went a little farther into the jungle while Joko was away. Now he can get some sights on it. This might give Janko some breathing room.
So this is what happened between Joko and Febiven. Of course, Joko on the retreat path from the jungle. He could see Febiven on this ward, but it wasn't really enough. He was trying to hide trees, trying to hide in plain sight. And Febiven just knows that he can pick this up. Because look, mid lane was pushed out towards Nukeduck. Nukeduck was just receiving the farm.
That was never going to work.
I mean, at that point, he didn't have a whole lot of options.
Yeah, but I mean, if you're a tree, you should hide in the jungle at least. Come on, man. All right, Kabushard. He doesn't know Jankos is here, but Jankos doesn't have level 6 just yet. Neither jungler does. Kabushard will have Equalizer available to him, and you can see H2K a little gun-shy to try and pull off the dive. He does know that Zac's there. There's the ping.
Yeah, has that feeling that Zac is around. Equalizer is available as you were looking towards. Now, it's a Hex Drinker attempt, or potentially, out of Odo, so for that first sight, he doesn't have a massive amount of damage. Of course, he had to retreat back after being killed. Kabushard has himself that Seeker's Arm Guard already, so a little bit tougher to kill under the tower.
Yeah, and so he'll be working his way towards that Johnny's Hourglass. Of course, Kabushard very comfortable on a champion like this Rumble. We've seen him play it time and again throughout the split. And Joko, he's able to get eyes on Jankos once again. Poor Jankos just keeps trying to grab farm wherever he can. Now he started off on the Raptor camp. But Joko just keeps pushing it back. He can threaten this over and over again. And Jankos can't finish the job right now. This is kind of slowing down both junglers, honestly.
But you can see how a few extra levels in the lane matchups actually has turned this back around for H2K. They're now able to contend with the mid lane push a little more. They're able to push further with Odo Amne. That gives Yankos the freedom with the vision control they already have through the top side river to be able to push forward. And now this game hasn't been much about the bottom lanes, but look at where Che and Nuclear are heading. They're trying to cut off Nukeduck because they recognize Nukeduck has likely pushed forward, what with Febivant recalling out. They're
going to
find Nukeduck on the Raptors. Now, Zac isn't here, but Tristana looking for it.
There's the Lantern, though. Vander, he shows up right at the right time to get the save. Now, Che and Nuclear have to go home empty-handed. Now, we only have a pair of kills apiece. As you said rightly, the action hadn't been in the bottom. It had been mostly up to the top, and we're right back into it again as Odoamne gets a big gnar against the wall. Kabashar throws down the equalizer, but it doesn't look equal to me. That's 2-on-1. Odoamne with the kill.
This has been a good turnaround out of H2K, using now their slightly pushed up lanes, making sure they can get Yankos up there to get the kill onto Kabashard again. No flash from Kabashard from before, so as soon as that gnar comes out from Odoamne, they know they can capitalize, stack the crowd control, and look to get in there for the kill. And there's no response. There's no second teleport user. Joker wasn't close enough for Vitality to actually turn that back around. And H2K have found two good openings now to turn the game back around. Only a 500 gold lead for Vitality, but a lead is still a lead.
That's true, and a lot of it is off the credit of what they were able to get done early. Joko derping aside, still had a lot of work in shutting down Yankos early on. Now we'll see how this fight unfolded, because of course Odoamne comes up with a big play.
Yeah, Odo with the double hop into the nine to the wall from there. It's pretty much easy to finish off Yankos. Doesn't quite get the ult he's looking for, but it
looks
didn't matter
like he taxied
at the end
a few minions on that
one. Didn't matter at the end.
Come
had
with
enough
me.
Damage.
It's all right.
It's probably not the most comfortable ride.
I
know we're
know.
Looking into new technology, like the Hyperloop and everything like that. Probably a lot more comfortable than Zac's Leds Bounce.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it is self-driving, so you don't need to worry about going in the right direction.
I hope so. It's a tube. The Hyperloop is a tube. If you're going anywhere else...
Oh, let's talk about Zac.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's what they have in common. But yeah. No seatbelts on that one, for sure. So, Kabashard, Odoamne, they'll continue to trade back and forth. And since the towers haven't been broken yet, my question to you, Stress, is this early attention that Vitality have given, this lead that they started to build up, it's not huge. Is it enough for them? When does this window close?
I mean, at this point, it's only a 300 gold lead, so no, it's not enough at this point. The way they transition this, though, is going to be a little bit through moving the bottom lane around. Now, they don't necessarily want to move out of this lane because it gives H2K the ability to push the tower very quickly. Using the Tahm Kench, using the Tristana, you can actually cover a lot of ground quickly and push down a tower. So Sealback and Vander, they want to wait longer into this game before they can move out of the lane, get the Thresh picks working, get this working in combination with Nukeduck. But if Yankos is giving all of this attention around the mid lane, around the top lane, Vitality have to start moving their own pieces in accordance to try and combat it.
You can see that it might be a little bit harder in practice than it is in theory. Febiman, of course, early start
good.
On those boots. He's able to move down quickly to this bottom side as they set up for the dive. Yankos jumping in. It's on to Steel back here. There's the flash. Lantern not even taken right now as Nuclear hops in. The Featherstorm is going to go out, but doesn't really matter. Febiman, he pulls him back in with the Shockwave. They tunnel the aggro, and they get themselves one quick pick, and that should turn into Dragon for H2K.
Really nice setup on the bottom lane. You could see how Yankos is looking to get into the lane, and now Vitality will try and respond in the middle lane, but they don't actually have enough time. And H2K have all of vision on river here, so unless Vitality know H2K have committed to that dragon, this is not the position they can continue to push in mid lane for Vitality. So we look back at that dive, H2K easily separate out Steelback and Vander, get the Lantern out early, it means Vander can't drag Steelback to further safety. And then from there, H2K know they can pick up the kills 4v2.
Yeah, this is something the analyst just was talking about, how Vitality just don't have the same level of execution that H2K have enjoyed. It's partially why we see them at the standings they are. And of course, the communication, it's just not been on the exact same level. So H2K can punish them for these types of mistakes.
Ping just went down on Steelback heading to the bottom side. What this tells H2K is there's no lane swap up to the top side, so they may look for another play like this. This is the play onto Steelback as Yankos came over. Ward goes on top of the Lantern to deny the Steelback. Observers making very clear that attempted denial. Didn't even get the Lantern through.
Yeah, that was sick, actually.
Yeah, really nice play out there. There's H2K able to make sure they punish Vitality on the bottom side.
All right, 13 minutes into this game, and of course H2K have been back in the lead after they got that kill out onto Steelback. Let's see where they decide to go next. Yankos sitting inside the mid lane, and he just hops right over into his Raptor pit. Vitality do have a couple of wards in that jungle, so they've spotted him out. But for the time being, HTK seem to be in a very comfortable place.
Yeah, they do. They're in a comfortable place. They know that Yankos has the impact to get onto the game. Their bottom lane is doing just fine at this point, up in CS, up with one kill. Orianna's in an acceptable position as well. One kill, only slightly behind in farm, and this composition is starting to build to the point where they're going to come online.
Yeah, and those two initiators we just saw working their way through the Scuttlecrab, that's been a big part of it right now. The Tahm Kench can open things up as this game goes on. Che, you know, we know him to be an incredible playmaker. We've seen him on the likes of Thresh, we've seen him on Tahm Kench and things like this, where he can set up these big plays, can be a big part of HTK winning his team fight. So Vitality, they really need to start getting something going right now if they want to hang on.
Once again, our observers highlighting just how much that Yankos is tracked through the jungle. And I like what you were talking about, the engage potential, you know, Yankos and his ability to get into the fights. But look, it's Joker that's looking for a play on middle lane, looking for tower first blood. As Fevin's here, Major Shockwave the wave.
Clears it away. Yep. Easy peasy. Nuke Duck takes a few more pot shots. It's almost down. Remember, we still don't have a single tower yet. So first tower blood is still up and available. But we might get more kills in a moment. Odawamne stepping through. He hops forward. Kabushark taking a lot of damage. There is the equalizer. He's trying to zoom his way back as Meganar comes out. In goes Yankos.
Nuke Duck there tagging.
He dashes away. Flash followed through. Here comes Che. Whoop. Although he does bring Nuke Duck to the party, or Febivin, I should say, who gets eaten back up after the hook came through.
And this is where HTK are trying to utilize this bottom lane to their advantage. Bring the Tristana with the Tahm Kench, bring everybody mid lane, try and push back some of that emphasis that Vitality have put on the middle lane, because Vitality desperately trying to play around this Lucian, desperately trying to around cracking the first tower. Now you can move the Lucian around, but that tower stands at like 200 health for now, and it means Vitality have to try and make yet another play onto it.
That was pretty sick, Joko. Yeah. Gets that smite, wins that fight. All right, Nuke Duck. I mean, it's really low in this mid tower right now, so everybody has been trying to push it down in the mid, in the bot, in the top, wherever they can find that advantage. But you can see Joko, he's kind of getting what he put in earlier up against Yankos, who brought Odawamne to help him clear out that jungle.
Well, it's almost turnaround's fair play. Joko won that smite fight, but Yankos actually was level 9 first. Yankos' impact in the fights, in the skirmishes early on, has actually given him the level advantage, and they're looking for it again. Here comes Odawamne, half the nar bar is there.
He's got the ball, he's gonna get pushed back for just a second. The Thresh box comes down, Shockwave pulls in two, and the cats come too late. Tower goes down, Nuclear comes up with a kill onto Vander, and Vitality are left empty-handed.
And what I like that HUK have done here is they make a small play to deny the wave push from Vitality at first, and then just repeat the play again. This time, catch with the ultimates, get the team fight started, get the kills, and get the tower. It's something that we've seen a lot of teams do step one, where you make a small play on, but you don't follow it up with this exchange. You don't go for the dive where you know you have the effective play here. Shockwave lands, good Shockwave on two. Yankos is able to get himself back out. And as you said, the Maokai ultimate isn't able to do too much more. HUK get out of that basically unscathed.
Yeah, in all honesty, it has been some pretty big plays here for HUK that have allowed them to keep this gold lead going. And crucially, the kills are going on to the carries. Febivin's got one of his own, as we talked about earlier. Nuclear, though, has those two. And you can see that last bit, you know, got him over the hump to grab himself the Infinity Edge and a Zeal to boot.
Yeah, a Zeal on top of it for Nuclear. And, you know, this is HUK's win condition, is set up a fight like that around a tower. You go up to a tower, you look in with the Zac, you try and get the team fight, you get the Shockwave, you get the tower, you win the game. That's their game plan for the rest of this one. They can very actively do it with the Zac, with the Tahm Kench. On the other side, Vitality, trying to deny that is quite difficult. They're likely going to be looking to get that Maokai ultimate through the fights, but they also want to try and get time with Nuke Duck in front of towers that don't have that defensive capability, where he can be out on a side lane trying to push through, but it's not the likes of a full 1-3-1 setup. There isn't always going to be time for Nuke Duck to be in the side lane because you're fighting against a very quick-to-engage composition out of HTK.
That's true. As long as they're the ones who can set up the fights, it seems like they do have a setup for success as the Scuttlecrab, or rather the Scuttlecrab's bigger brother, gets taken, Rift Herald, by HTK. For Vitality, you mentioned earlier in the pick and ban, they do have a relatively well-balanced team fight, but it seems like there will be somewhat of a window since Nuke Duck is so fixated on the early game. Kabushard in the mid, he'll be the one that they're looking for, and of course Steelback as it goes later.
And Nuke Duck is going to end up being some sense of wave clear from this as well. The culling is going to have to be utilized in a wave clear stance. And that means he's got to step close enough to a tower that if Jankos and Febiven are there, that's a very treacherous situation. Look, Rift Herald still survived after the tower push with quite a lot of health as well. Equalizer comes out now, but look, this Rift Herald has already done the damage. This tower is not going to heal up.
Yeah, that is a little unfortunate. And I can understand Yamato's frustration here. Remember, Vitality, they need to win out if they want to have any chance of making it into the playoffs. And at the moment, H2K leading the charge with a 2,000 gold lead and a tempo advantage, not looking too hot.
One area that Vitality could look to turn this back around is once this Righteous Glory is completed on Joker, that's the item he's looking for, try and find somebody like Febiven if they're on their own. Now, those errors don't happen very often. We've seen it happen a handful of times with Febiven, but if you can get the likes of a Maokai, a Lucian, to get that initial pick, maybe bring the Thresh along as well, try and get that pick, that's where Vitality can open the game back up. But H2K against teams that typically are below them on the standings look very clean when making plays like this. A little bit on a different page. Nuclear was anticipating that Nuketuk would go up the river, I think.
But yeah, juked. So Nuketuk is able to get out scot-free that time.
Juketuk.
Yeah, wow. I can't believe I didn't think of that one.
I'm sure we were saying that in 2013.
Probably.
That was
a long time ago, Stress. I wasn't even around back then. But Nuclear back down on the bottom side, pushing up against Nuketuk. And he has a lot of damage, though. Nuketuk's got to be careful. And, of course, there's that Tahm Kench protection there, that frustrating levels of death denial that he can always bring. And Che, no stranger to it.
No. Che, I think that was one of his real big standout moments here in Europe. Ooh, Joko gets dragged over the wall.
Oh, he wants to go all in. Jankos does not get locked up. And the bounce, oh, that's a long hook, but it's not going to be followed.
That was one of the opportunities we were talking about, where if they can find H2K out on their own, it actually ended up being beneficial that Joko got dragged so far away. The problem is, H2K use a lot to back out, because they know Odoron is getting the top tower. They know there is the attempt on the bottom tower between Nuclear and Nuketuk.
And Nuketuk, he gets popped back by the buster shot of Nuclear, but of course, Che once again there to keep him alive. And you know, the top lane keeps pushing in favor of H2K right now because Kabushard just can't match the pressure that Odoamne is dishing.
And this means some of the big ultimates now not available. Joko's ultimate, Nuketuk's ultimate not available for any kind of skirmish. It gives H2K the freedom to just go to the dragon now. No real impact here can come from Vitality because their big teamfight ultimates that they're going to rely on can't be utilized here. So Mountain Drake going in favor of H2K. Only the first one of the game at 21 minutes in. You can see how little focus H2K have had on this because they've been winning out elsewhere on the map.
But now that they have it, it's going to make their demolition on these towers even more deadly. You have a Tristana already that is a veritable wrecking ball against towers. Now you have the Mountain Drake. You're going to do a little bit extra damage to those objectives as well. So it's going to be harder and harder for Vitality to stop themselves from losing ground. And you know, there is late game potential for this team, of course. The Xayah is going to be pretty instrumental in making it happen. And credit to Nuketuk, he does keep the side wave pressure up. Vitality aren't folding at the moment. It's something we've criticized them in the past for slowly giving ground, not taking action. And now, they're making plays. They're not all working, but they are doing them.
Especially Vitality of old, where they kind of would run out of things to do. I think this Vitality lineup has had less of that problem. They've been attempting to make plays. Some of that, I think, you can attribute to the fact they were playing Tahm Kench or Vander a whole bunch. Thresh is a little more difficult to have that kind of impact, because it's, can I flay somebody or can I hook somebody? If no, probably can't make too many plays without trying to just get that vision first. Whereas Tahm Kench, you can be like, I see someone in the side lane, go, go, go.
Yeah, that is fair. And you could definitely have much more reliable plays with the Tahm Kench than you can with the Thresh. But remember, it is Vander piloting him. This is a guy with a lot of LCS experience. We used to call him Vander Life. Back when, you know, he was really making these epically massive plays, back in the Rockat days.
And that's why it's not a knock on Vander at all. It's just that the champion style, Thresh from ahead, super great. You just hook everybody in sight. You just, woo, kill everybody. Take out anything that moves. Thresh from behind, a whole different story. You've got to really stretch to make plays. It's about trying to punish any small mistake out from their opponents. Like, if they can catch Febiven or Jankos out once again, but even then, you got to get through the Zac passive. You got to try and fight against the Shockwave, the inevitable Gnar teleport that'll come in.
Yeah, and I think the thing that really sucks about it is there is a Tahm Kench on the enemy team, so you might be able to hit all those hooks, and he's just like, nope.
Technically, they may still be a miss then, right? if you don't get the kill, but that wouldn't be on Vander at that point.
That's like the worst thing when you lock in Thresh and your opponent's like, ha ha, Tahm Kench.
It's even worse when you lock in Ashe
or like
the enemy.
Morgana.
The enemy support is just like Tahm Kench. Great. Okay. Yeah. Deny everything.
Doesn't work for me. Whenever I play Tahm Kench, I just end up dying a lot.
That's fair.
Probably says something about me more than the champion. Though.
Yeah, considering your main champion is singed.
Hey, why do you keep telling people that?
You keep telling people that.
No, I say he's my favorite.
Oh, okay.
There's a difference. All right. But anyways, look what HTK have been able to do, right? Like, they keep the vision clear.
Ooh.
They're able to make moves together as a team here.
They're trying to punish Odo Ame here. He does have his flash. He's going to be mini-Gnar and can't get out of there. But look, HTK commit onto the Baron immediately because, look, Noob Duck, no teleport available. This is Vitality committing into the bottom lane when they didn't have full vision control on the top side. They hardly had any. TP comes through. Vitality, they're going to try and fight
this one. Oh, Joko has to burn his flash and he can't get over the wall.
Joko's going to take it down.
Smite away, Joko nearly bought it there. However, Jankos, he gives his life to try and keep them out of that Baron pit. So that is one Baron buff removed. But the rest of H2K will make it out.
Oh, I didn't see who actually tagged the blast cone there, but that looked to have been touch and go. Joko clearly saw the play in his eyes. He was like, Jankos is out of the pit. I can get in there. I can steal it down.
He flashed a little bit too far ahead to actually make the insta play, but man, that would have been a highlight. Unfortunately, Vitality just a little slow on the jump and they lose out on the big purple worm.
And it's not necessarily just slow on the jump, they actually just committed bot side. They thought, okay, if we take Cabochard down, he's got the TP, he can come back up to the top side, we can actually get this. But I'd love to see what vision control they had before the Baron play actually started, because as it was in progress, H2K had full control and there was no way Vitality had a proper read on exactly how far it's going, but it's a nice play out of H2K to just go directly to the Baron, know they can get it. Vitality is stuck waiting around in bushes topside trying to kill Odo Ame, who basically knows everybody's still there. So, look at the vision. This is what Vitality can see. If everyone throws out a shockwave to deny Joko and Vander's pathway to the topside, really well, trying to just deny everything. Then Jankos jumps out, 800 health from the Baron. Joko,
he gets Buster Shot away from it.
That was beautiful. By Nuclear.
Give some serious props to him, man.
Yeah,
Nuclear
that's actually
has been very clutch in a lot of situations.
Very clutch. I thought it was the blast cone. He wasn't quite lined up. Well, Joko's getting caught out again.
Yeah, okay. Well, I think this is not going to end well for him. That is 4-on-1, and Nuclear just says, I'll take it. Yeah, give it to me.
Into the tower, and unfortunately, H2K now is starting to wind up into this passage of the game where towers are going to fall very quickly in their favor. You got the Tristana, you got the Baron buff, you got the Orianna here in the lane, just able to push with that Mountain Drake they already took. And now Jankos basically just blocks in the middle. He's able to just deny Vitality any shortcut towards their own base. And H2K, they're going to look to push down an inhibitor tower already.
Yeah, and Nuclear is nearly at that three-item Tristana spike where he just becomes an absolute monster. So there is really not a whole lot Vitality can do other than just a master play flank. And Kabushar's got no TP. He's obviously already waiting around here, but H2K are playing on two lanes. The siege is proving very successful, and it seems like Vitality's dreams are starting to go down the drain.
A lot of this game turned back around from that 7-minute-ish mark where H2K put down the vision, they pushed the mid lane, pushed the top lane out, got the jungle control with vision, and Jankos suddenly found his element. The whole early game, the first few minutes of this game, was all Vitality trying to punish Jankos. But it wasn't enough. H2K, as a unit, turned back around, are able to put the game back in their favor, and now we're 20 minutes later, they're in full control.
Yeah, looking to close this one out right now as the tower falls and the shockwave takes down Nuke Duck. Although it ends up being a finishing blow, courtesy of Nuclear, and he just keeps on the front line. The rest of H2K not far behind. A few Baron-empowered minions will be enough for them to plow through this tower, to break into the base, and Vitality, there is no counterplay.
Yeah, this is what the team composition is made to do. You just fight just underneath the enemy tower. You've got enough survivability and great team fighting to be able to take it to Vitality, and you just break every structure that is behind them. Very swift, meticulous composition comes out of H2K, and they execute it beautifully.
This is the masterful execution, as you said. So there was the start of it all. And a big front line in that Gnar.
Yep, Shockwave comes through. Nuke Duck is able to flash it, but Nuclear already has that auto attack in traveling. And Joko kind of zoned out of the fight, can't quite get in, had used the ultimate, was trying to basically get anything he could, but at that point, doesn't really have much more to offer.
I mean, wasn't able to do a whole lot. And you can see why it was so critical for Vitality to try and shut down Jankos early, because he's been a big part of that front line, but so is Odo Ame now, so is Che, and there's just no chance that Vitality have been able to get into those backline situations to find the flanks they need. And, you know, it was critical that they played the early game map, but we know that Vitality, they just generally don't get a whole lot of these early leads. Not for lack of trying, but against a team like H2K, just better execution, just crisper play. It's hard to do.
It is. It's very hard to do, but H2K themselves on this execution want to go again.
Nice dodge.
I was having a conversation with Senkooks last week when we were on the analyst desk, talking about how strong Orianna is as a pick, and you can see Febben using it beautifully. Good offensively, tied with a Zac, great defensively, especially against people that are trying to engage. Look, this ball creates so much pressure.
Oh!
Ooh, steal back, force to ult.
Yeah, it also forces that to happen every now and again, and it's such a low cooldown for the Shockwave as well. I mean, that's why Orianna's been such a staple for such a long time in League of Legends.
And such a staple blind pick as well. There are almost no matchups that completely deny Orianna. Lucian is a tough one, don't get me wrong, but you get into the game later on when you team fight like this.
They're going to try it. Although Oduwamne, he gets melted through. This might be the opportunity here as Che was standing on top of the equalizer. Didn't take too much damage, but Yanko's a little too low to get back into it. And H2K don't push their luck.
Yeah, just split second between Oduwamne actually transforming there, but he was caught chain CC'd and wasn't able to get his ultimate through. So nice catch by Vitality. That's what they've been looking to do for the last 20 minutes of this game. But unfortunately, it's not a reliable basis, and that's what makes it difficult to pull off here. Vitality looking for any area that they can while they're slowly losing one Nexus Tower.
Yeah, we talked about the Miracle Fight. I mean, there's always an opportunity, right? And steal back. You know, we've been talking about Nuclear constantly this game, but he's building up his items as well. Xayah in the late game is a monstrous team fighter. There is always a chance if H2K, they mess up their execution, lose more than just Oduwamne next time, but it will take quite a lot for that to happen.
Yeah, it will take quite a lot for that. Steelback, so much is going to rely on him getting past this third item, getting even further into the game. So that means the rest of his team for now have to kind of stem the bleeding. They'll have to use as much of their wave clear as possible out of the culling and all that, but look, it's not available right now, so every time Nukejack steps forward to try and clear it with a piercing light and then a combination of auto attacks, it just doesn't really have that impact, because then Febben's just gonna Q Shockwave him, like, every single time.
Yeah, that's already back off cooldown. Yeah, Febben's pretty beastly right now. I mean, we've been talking a lot about Nuclear, Febben's been big, but H2K have executed this composition masterfully, considering the tough situation they were put in early on with Yankos, and just plowing through the tower now. Yankos looking for Cabo Shard. He gets them pulled on in. Cabo might go golden, but right about now, he is going to be falling down. A big shockwave pulls in for Yankos, coming in with no fear and no health bar, but he is still able to stay alive, and they have pushed Vitality all the way back to the fountain. One shut down, that will not be enough. A double kill from Febben. Minion streaming into the base. A triple kill for Febben. And in game number one, H2K show Vitality who is boss, taking the series up 1-0.
Oduwamne practically walked right through that Maokai ultimate. Nexus ends up falling, and H2K with a very clear game plan come through. Execute well. Vitality just couldn't contend in those skirmishes, in the fights underneath the tower. It's exactly what H2K were looking for.
Yeah, and I feel like Vitality, they had their game plan, and in the early game, they did make it work for them. But like it happens in so many Vitality games, they just ran out of gas.
Yeah, especially when Nuclear on the other side had 5 kills, Febben had 4 kills. Like, the damage threats on the side of H2K just really punished Vitality in this period of the game where the Lucian wasn't having the massive amount of success. They were still waiting for the Xayah, and the team fights were kind of crumbling before Cabo Shard could actually get into the game. So I can see what Vitality were looking for with the composition. I think it's possible to make it work, but look, when H2K are that clean on their comp, I think it's such a tight window that you've actually got to try and make the play.
Yeah, I wonder what Vitality needs to do for the next game. Composition-wise, obviously, we know keeping it simple is going to help, but should they tunnel on that early game in every role, or should they maybe go more towards the scaling side of things?
No, I think you should probably keep at least one scaling component, and that always seemingly looks better on Steelback, but I don't think there are any massive issues with that pacing on it, just H2K executing very well.
Well, they certainly executed all the way to 1-0 on the series. Now, H2K had full control in that game one. Let's head over to the analyst desk to break it all down.
Thank you very much, Brian. I think it's pretty safe to say full control. There were a few moments in the early game that weren't quite as H2K favored, but after that, it did feel like 100% the classic, well, when H2K is informed, the classic H2K snowball coming in and closing up. What did you think was the biggest factor looking at that early game? Because there was it was relatively calm in terms of early action for the most part.
I think that Jankos was the biggest thing because what we saw from Joko was we saw a few good early plays. He put a lot of pressure down onto Jankos. I think he took advantage of the recent nerfs that did happen to Zac, where his clear is a little slower. He takes a little bit more damage in the jungle. And I thought that was a good awareness, but he didn't really do anything else. Whereas Jankos, he was always looking for opportunities. He wanted to set up a bunch of dives around the map. And I think a lot of them were extremely successful.
Yeah, it definitely was the case. And I think it's surprising because Joko had a successful play where they ganked the Gnar and it felt like it worked out for them, but wasn't able to transition it to anything else. However, Jankos, just kind of the crux of so many of these aggressive tower dive plays. And when we look at this one in particular and this specific moment, I thought we might get the whole play as well. But you can see that ward being laid down. On top of this being a smart map play, just a beautiful outplay as well.
Yeah, and you can see on your mini map, like the pink, the control wards were set up in the river. The deep vision was invested already from the bottom lane because they had the push. Everything was set up beautifully and everything was well executed. There was no answer because the TP and flash had already been used topside. And this is just a clear demonstration of H2K's understanding of macro and how to play around the map. They see an opportunity in the bottom lane, they go for it, they know that it's not risky, and that's where their snowball starts. And they did this time and time again. They got a good gank up onto the Rumble in top lane. Both Jankos and Odo executed very nicely. And they did the same sort of dive in the mid too.
And that's the thing, is I feel like we didn't see those repeat ganks from Joko, but we did see them from Jankos. And it's easy to forget all the ganks that didn't work out in the favor of H2K in terms of Jankos leaping in, throwing down some damage, but not able to get a summoner or any tangible advantage. He lived top lane in a lot of the early game. And when he does get that final gank to get his lane ahead, he knows he can leave and he starts going other places. And I feel like this game, because the laning phase felt so even between the individual players, was pretty much all about Jankos.
Yep, it really was. And then when they moved towards the Baron, that's really where they closed things out. I was a little worried when they did start off the Baron.
I'm hoping we get the opportunity to talk to Prolly at some point and ask him what stage he was at. Obviously, the start here is fantastic. H2K, this is a good setup. It's confident. They're pressing their advantages. You mentioned earlier about how good their vision was. But
then jumping out of the Baron pit when it has 1,000 HPs, like, Febiven even had to flash into the pit, QW to burst it down, and Jankos gives up his life. And you could see afterwards when the team was talking to their coach, I could just see Jankos being like, look, listen, coach, listen, listen. It's not what it looked like, okay? I knew the team had it.
I was going to hit the Maokai, then we're not going to risk the 50-50. I swear I had it. Yeah, whatever it was.
It was a little risky, but fortunately, because of the full vision control that H2K had in the pit, Vitality, they couldn't get in. They didn't know how close they were to stealing.
And now we present to you the EU LCS belt cam, starring Prolly and Jankos. Not the case this time around. And now moving forward to next game, this feels like a dominant form of H2K. If you're on the side of Vitality, what do you do to adjust? I feel like we've put a ton of pressure on Joko, but is it all just on Joko?
I don't know, because I think that the Lucian pick was a little bit odd as well. I think that if you're going to pick something that's relying on getting an early snowball and being pretty dominant, your Orianna shouldn't be the one that's making all these map movements and being able to roam around to set up these dives, getting an early kill onto the Maokai in the river. Like, these sort of things shouldn't be allowed if your goal is to play an early aggressive mid laner. So I think that while Nukeduck played fine, I wanted to see a little bit more from him. And also, like, we didn't actually get to see any sort of opportunity of team fighting or team play. And when it's such a heavy meta about forcing fights, that should be an avenue that Vitality look to take advantage of if they want to shut down a team like H2K.
And I'm curious, in a meta where there are so many tank junglers who aren't known for crazy aggressive early games, obviously Zac and Maokai can force some successful ganks, is it appropriate to play such a dominant early laner? We've seen so many control mages coming out in the mid lane. Like, is that just the better route for mid laners right now?
Ooh, I think it depends, right? Because what we have been seeing is sometimes you'll pick something like a Syndra, which can set you up nicely so that you can be super active in the early game. But I think that, I don't know. I honestly think that it's difficult to assess what the best thing is because it very much depends on the composition. Like, we saw Faker bring out the Lucian. He made it work perfectly fine in the composition that he had. But in this situation, I felt like that the goals of the Lucian didn't align with what the team composition wanted to do. I felt like they had really good team fighting, and the idea was to get an early snowball and force a few mid-game fights. But because they didn't get that early lead, they weren't able to transition into fights, and Jankos had way more pressure. Orianna's,
definitely turned against them. Well, H2K are looking to close out the series when they step on stage for game 2 right after this. We'll be right back. Don't go anywhere.